This video shows the successes I've had with small home improvements to insulation and draft reduction around our house, which I undertook during the summer months. I'll use before and after thermal images to show you the difference a few small changes can make. By and large, I wanted to do this without spending heaps of money. In most areas, I stuck to this. In one area, I failed. In no particular order, let's start with the windows. Our UPVC double glazed windows were fitted when the house was built back in 2001. We have a 4-bedroom detached house. It was built by what was then a small independent house builder, and I suspect the windows were sort of middle of the range in terms of quality and price point. Jumping forward 20 years, and the improvements to hinges, materials, tolerances, glazing, and general fit and finish, our original windows are arguably not the best at preventing drafts compared to a modern window. In 2012, we had a single-storey extension built across the rear of the house. The new kitchen window that was installed is far superior to our existing windows at keeping out drafts. Both types of window are double glazed, have the same look and finish, but the new window is streets apart from the original windows in terms of fit and finish and snugness on closing and opening. The back of the house faces the prevailing winds and it's open to the fields. It gets the worst and the best of the weather, depending on the time of year. Here's a few clips of how drafty the windows were. This was filmed on a very windy day with the wind gusting. The wind direction was full on to the back of the house where these bedroom windows are situated. As you can see, there's quite a draft coming in through the seals on the openers. This is just one of the opening windows, but they're all the same really. The high-tech testing equipment I'm using is a wooden skewer with a single ply piece of toilet paper taped to it. You could use a joss stick or incense stick if you wanted to. The seals or gaskets are made of rubber and have a D-shaped cross-section to them. This D profile had flattened from years of constant pressure against the window frame when the windows were closed. I decided to replace all the gaskets as a starting point. This was a much cheaper option than replacing all the windows. I totted up how many opener windows we had around the house. I had to do this about three times, twice from memory, and finally a walk the house, making a note of each window. I counted 5 downstairs and 12 upstairs, 17 opening windows in total. The next step was to source some replacement gaskets. I looked online and found a company who did replacements for UPVC windows. There was a large array of different colours, styles, materials and cross-sections to choose from. Thankfully, they did a sample pack of gaskets and they did a chart so you could find the one and how to identify it once you'd found the one that actually fitted. So after a few goes with different profiles, I settled on the one that was almost identical to the profile that we already had, with the exception it had not been flattened by 20 years of pressure on it. I ordered the required length from their website. I needed a gasket that sealed around the 4 sides of each window that opened, and another flipper type strip to seal around the 4 sides of the frame that the window closed against. After measuring the 4 sides of the opener and frames, I worked out how much gasket I would need. I added 10% wastage in total and then placed the order online. The new gasket soon arrived and it was an easy job to pull out the old and replace with a new. The gasket is made from rubber and it's a push fit and held into the groove in the UPVC frame by friction. There's a small sort of tab or foot that pushes into the groove and holds it in place. I was able to replace the gaskets from the inside of the house. There was no need for ladders or scaffolding on the outside of the house. I did use a small set of steps to reach the very top of some of the windows. It took about 4 hours to replace all the gaskets. Then I waited for the next windy day. When I retested with my high-tech draft excluder, I found that even with the new gaskets, it did not completely prevent drafts. Reduce, yes. Prevent, no. The main leak culprit was where the opening windows pivoted at the hinge side of the frame. These hinges were already at their maximum snugness against the frame, so could not be tightened to reduce that gap any further. The new gaskets were an improvement, however, I felt I could still do better. I looked online for a slightly fatter profile gasket and found a foam alternative. I only needed this for the hinge side of each opener. I worked out how much I needed and placed the order for that. This is a thicker foam gasket compared to the newly installed rubber gasket. You can see it is much thicker. Being foam, it squashes and compresses much more readily than the rubber. It's perfect to seal up a large gap. Here is a clip of me testing on another windy day with the foam gasket now in place. As you can see, there's a marked improvement. Here is a side-by-side comparison for you before any upgrades, and again with the foam gasket installed. On cold and windy days, the area around the windows and the rooms overall is much warmer. Before, you could hear the wind whistling through the gaps. Now you can hear the wind outside, and it remains outside. I'm sure that by upgrading the windows to better frames and glass that even more benefits can be obtained. However, this would be a much larger investment for a smaller return in performance. I also found other small gaps and drafts with my trusty search and destroy draught detector tool. Here's our fireplace in the living room. We never use the fire. It's a gas fire that looks great, but you end up heating the chimney rather than the room. Just look at the draw up that chimney. It's sucking our hot air from the room. The resolution was a well-placed piece of bubble wrap up the chimney. I added a handwritten note onto the igniter button for the fire to remind me to remove the plastic before lighting, if we ever do at some point light it in the future. This is the after video, and the results speak for themselves. No draw up the chimney now, and again you can't hear the wind either. Before, you could hear the wind on very windy days whistling up the chimney. There's some other gaps I identified and sealed with exterior grade sealant. This is where the plumber had not sealed the exit around the waste pipe. In fact, he'd not sealed the inside either, and you could feel the draft inside the kitchen cupboards. This waste pipe is located at the back of the house and again gets strong winds in the autumn and the winter. As I mentioned in the introduction, these fixes are not major DIY jobs. It was a case of doing many small improvements, which then all add up to a much larger overall impact. This is our loft hatch in the office, where we have a small loft space above it. The office has three sides with external facing walls. It's on the north side of the house, which means it's really in the coldest part of the house. Cool in the summer, cooler in the winter. When sitting in the office on windy days, you could feel the draft around the loft hatch. This meant that our hot air from our central heating was leaching into the loft space through the gaps around the loft hatch. The loft hatch cover was just resting on a rebate on the loft hatch, and the cover was just a piece of plywood and not insulated. I set about adding some polystyrene, which is stuck down with hot melt glue via a glue gun. It's a bit rough and ready, but our loft insulation is not judgmental, so that's all good. I then added a couple of bolts to help secure the hatch and bring it down tight against the rebate around the loft hatch. Here's the thermal image, which shows the after effect. I'm no thermal imaging expert, it's fair to say. This image was taken inside, pointing up at the loft hatch. The scale running along the top of this image gives you an idea of the temperatures that you were looking at. White is the hottest, and black, sort of dark blue, being the coolest. On my camera, the areas with the maximum minimum temperatures are identified by a square and the temperature in degrees centigrade alongside it. So the hottest part of the ceiling is 15.7 degrees centigrade, that's 60 degrees Fahrenheit in old money, and the coldest is 12.7 degrees centigrade. I can see from this image that there's a small area of insulation around the edge of the loft frame that I need to improve, as well as the edges where the cover meets the framework. It's a shame I didn't take some before thermal images, as the majority of the photo would have been blue or black. Incidentally, this photo was taken when the outside temperature was 0 degrees centigrade or 32 degrees Fahrenheit, to give you a reference point for the temperature differential between inside and outside. When we had our extension built, we chose angled sunken downlighters because the ceiling was sloping, and this was long before I appreciated the impact to the fabric of the building and its thermal insulation by cutting holes in the ceiling above a ventilated roof space. What we didn't realise was that when it was windy, the wind would blow across the opening in the spotlight and sounded like we had owls in the roof. If you've ever blown across the top of a bottle, that's the sort of sound it made. It took us a while to track down what was causing the problem. Also, this meant that our heat was disappearing up through the gaps too. I replaced the spots with LED closed versions, and now we don't have any owls anymore. Plus, the extension is a lot warmer too. I added more loft insulation in both lofts, the small one above the office that I've already talked about, and we now have a minimum depth of 300 millimetres across the whole of both lofts. This is double the thickness that we originally had. This is the photo of the original insulation, which is the bare minimum 4 inches or 100 millimetres. In this photo, I'm installing a raised floor storage area so I don't flatten the additional insulation I was about to lay down. So compressing the insulation takes away its effectiveness to trap air between its layers. The new insulation was laid in the opposite direction to the original to reduce air gaps and thereby reduce heat loss. Whilst in the loft area, I tackle the sunken spotlights too. And there are three of them on the landing. I replaced the bulbs with LED versions some time ago. However, you can see that they're not snugly fitting against the ceiling. There was an air gap around the bulbs and the light fitting. Or places for hot air to leak past. Cue three downlight covers. They allow you to run insulation right up and over the covers. This reduces any venting and trickling of warm air from the house into the loft space. These are easy to install with a bead of silicone and press down until they dry to form an airtight seal around the plasterboard. And just have a look at these two photos side by side. Look at the loft hatch cover. I'll come back to that in a minute. There's a spotlight to the right of it that has a downlight cover on it and is fully insulated. In this photo, the middle spotlight in the photo is situated really close to the cold water storage tank, so too close to get a downlight cover over it without hitting the wooden framework which supports the water tank. So not the best position, but hey. But just look at the difference between the two downlighters. In the thermal image photo, you can really see the colder areas. That blue circle is the downlighter with no cover or insulation near it. I will replace these downlighters with similar ones I put downstairs, you know, the sealed units. There's no insulation under the cold water storage tank to prevent the water inside it from freezing during a cold snap. Water expands as it freezes, which would end up splitting the plastic tank, and then it leaks as it thaws. That's the green patch that you can see in the foreground of that thermal image. I did encase the wooden framework that the tank was sitting on insulation, so there's less spill out into other areas of the loft. Coming back to the loft hatch, I really need to improve the insulation around here. I've not done anything with this yet, so work in progress. You can see how much cooler the surrounds are. This is the loft hatch open. The door has some insulation on it, but the edges are nothing. As you can see, it's just a piece of thin plastic. More to do in that area. Installing a new front door was the biggest cost and change we made this year. It needed a professional company to make that change, you know, e.g. removing the old door and frame and installing a new one. I have made a separate video on this, so I won't go into the full details here, and there's a link for that video up in the top right-hand corner if you want to go and look at it. This first one is the old front door taken from inside looking back at the door. You can clearly see in the thermal image that there's a lot of dark blue areas, lighter blue and green areas that are getting cold air coming into the house and creating cold spot in the frame and surrounds. This is the outside looking back at the old front door. These sort of inside and outside images were taken when the outside temperature was 7 degrees centigrade and 44 degrees Fahrenheit. You can actually feel the draft coming in past the door seals. And you could even see daylight under the bottom of the door, hence that yellow band at the bottom of the door where our heat is seeping out. This is the new front door, and the next few images were taken when my weather app said it was 11 degrees Celsius outside. However, as you can see from the thermal imaging camera, the coldest part of the photo is registered at 6.4 degrees Celsius. The door temperature is around 9.1 degrees centigrade. The hottest part is where the light on the doorbell is at 12.3 degrees centigrade. Looking at the inside of the door in these two shots, you can see that the coldest part is 13.8 degrees Celsius, which is right on the hinge area of the door. The maximum temperature is 17.8 degrees Celsius at the top of the wall just above the door. These next images were taken when we had the central heating on and set to 20 degrees Celsius, 68 degrees Fahrenheit, and it was 0 degrees Celsius outside. So this is like a worst case scenario. Looking at the outside photos, the warmest point is the top left-hand corner, where there's some heat leakage around the frame where the door pivots. It indicates 6.1 degrees Celsius in the top corner compared to 0.1 degrees Celsius at the very top of the picture, which is our plastic guttering on the outside of the house. Just on the left side of the thermal image photo, you can actually see my reflection in the window. I'm holding the camera with two bare hands and no gloves on. The middle portion of the door is 3.1 degrees centigrade in temperature. This is the inside, shot taken at the same time when it was 0 degrees Celsius outside. The coldest part, shown in blue, is right at the bottom of the frames on either side of the door at 10.6 degrees Celsius. The important thing here, there is no drafts. The hall is so much warmer than it was before, and this has had a major benefit on the warmth across the whole house, as all rooms lead off from the hallway. Hence why we spent a large chunk of money on the front door. As a result of these changes, we have turned down our gas boiler to number one, its lowest setting. It used to be on 4, sometimes 5, to keep the house warm. I've measured the flow and return temperatures of our central heating to and from the boiler. Outbound is now 40 degrees Celsius, and the return flow back to the boiler is 36.7 degrees Celsius. We're using less gas than we did before these improvements, even though we leave it on now 24/7 and set the temperature to 20 degrees centigrade for the radiators. The boiler just sort of chips in and out, topping up the base heat. As I've said, there are still some jobs to do. Just look at our back door and the cat flap at the bottom of the door. Major heat loss there. All the red you can see is the gas boiler on the left-hand side of the photo and the central heating pipes running up the walls on the right. There's actually a radiator just out of sight at the bottom of the frame there. I thought it was worth sharing my results to date. So many small improvements all work together to make an overall noticeable difference. Any questions, then dive into the comments below and I'll pick them up. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you on the next video. Take care. Bye.